dearly beloved, our third speaker is highly esteemed personality. He is indeed respected Dr. D.C. Katoch. Dr. Katoch, sir, has started his career as an Ayurvedic teacher in the year 1993, and his work journey is inspirational to many like us. Currently, he is assigned with various prestigious liabilities in health sectors of Ayurveda India. Amongst few, I would like to mention here. He is advisor, Ayurveda Ministry of Ayush, Government of India, head drugs policy section, director in charge PCIMNH, director in charge BLIM, Ministry of Ayush, Government of India, and many more national as well as international activities exhibiting Ayurveda, including World Health Organization. As he is involved in policy level aspects of Ayurveda, I now request Dr. Katoch sir to give a speech on regulatory aspects of Ayurveda pharmacy education. Over to you, Dr. Katoch sir.
Okay, thank you. Am I audible? Am I audible? Hello? Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible. Please.
Okay, fine. Honorable Vice Chancellor and the Director of IPGTRA, Dr. Professor Anup Patelji, Dr. Chaudhary ji, Ranjit Puranik ji, and the principal of this Indian Institute of Ayurvedic Pharmaceutical Sciences, Jamnagar, Dr. Modha ji, and all the faculty members and the participants in this webinar. First of all, let me thank Professor E.M. Mehta and Dr. P.N.D. Kuru, whose brainchild is celebrating 22nd birth anniversary of this institute. Now, there is another reason to greet the institute and the custodians of this Gujarat Ayurveda University and the institutions under this, that this institute, this complex has been designated as a institute for, of national importance. So that is another feather in the cap of this university and this institutional complex, that they are enjoying the status of institute of national importance. Friends, the topic which I am going to speak on, that is relating to this regulation of pharmacy education, pharmacy profession of Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani, and Homeopathy. I picked up many points from the presentation of Dr. Chaudhary and from Mr. Ranjit Purane, and particularly one important point which Dr. Chaudhary raised, that the manpower requirement means the pharmacy manpower, which is required for our sector, particularly in the teaching institutions, in the regulatory framework, like as drug inspectors, or even on the production side, even on the quality control side in the manufacturing units, we need a trained manpower of pharmacy. And the point which Mr. Ranjit Puranik raised, I think I'm very much touched by that point, and that is, we need not, means our stakeholders, particularly the stakeholders of the pharmaceuticals, they need not navigate, they need to comply. They need to comply to the regulatory requirements, they need to comply to the standards, quality standards, and the other standards set up by the different bodies, by the government agencies. So the navigation, I think navigation is not important, important is compliance. And I think for that, this pharmacy education and the pharmacy the profession, that it is very, very important that the compliance to the regulatory requirements and the regulatory provision. Since I'm going to speak on Ayush standardization, Ayush regulation, friends, this regulation, before we start the regulation, the prerequisite is standards. What we regulate without standards? Unless we have the standards, only then we can check. So standardization, that is the prerequisite for regulation. And standardization it all depends upon the policy. It all depends upon the policy. If you see the growth of Ayush in the country, at the time of independence, when India became free in 1947, there was a policy support for Ayush systems. That is why these systems were given official recognition. All the systems, Ayurveda, Yoga, Unani, Naturopathy, Siddha, Homeopathy, and recently, about 10 years back, we saw Ripa. So all these systems, they were given official recognition. So it means that recognition was given because of there was a policy support from government officials. But that policy support initially, it was tolerant. It was tolerant policy. There were no regulations, no standards, no standards. The first attempt through the policy for standardization, it started in 1962, when the first pharmacopoeia committee was set. And the work or the responsibility given to the pharmacopoeia committee was to identify the books, authoritative books, which can be included in the Drugs and Cosmetic Act in the first schedule, so that a very specific definition of Ayurveda, Siddha, Unani drugs could be given. And that definition was incorporated in 1964. So that happened because of that policy. So it means the policy support that changed in 1964, it means initially there was a tolerant policy support, but later on it was inclusive policy support. Like other forms of medicine, like allopathic medicine, so means standardization, this concept of standardization, so that was passed on to the Ayurveda, Siddha, Unani, and that pharmacopoeia committee was there. Now, from 1964, means when this definition, the legal definition of Ayurveda, Siddha, Unani, and then later on the definition of homeopathy drug was also included in the Drugs and Cosmetic Act. And if you see that in the Drugs and Cosmetic Act, the definition of homeopathy drug is not there. It is only for Ayurveda, Siddha, Unani. This is very interesting. There was only one umbrella definition of drug, which was given in 1940. So that definition that covered all kinds of drugs, but majorly it was only for chemical drugs, pharmaceutical drugs. And then the definition of this Ayurveda, Siddha, Unani drug, that was carved out in 1964, and it was incorporated under Section 3A and Section 3H1. That is related to property, patent or property. Now, between 1964 to 1983, as I told you that there was a inclusive policy support from the government of India, in this period, what happened? In this period, first of all, a regulatory body under the provisions of Indian Medicine Center Council Act that was created, that was for standardization of the education and the quality control of education, CCIM came up in 1970, when this Indian Medicine Center Council Act was framed. And just after 3 years, then the Homeopathy Center Council Act was. So again, this was because IMC, Indian Medical Council Act, it came in 1956. But there was no regulatory body, there was no regulatory provisions for Ayurveda, Siddha, Unani education, as well as practice. So the regulation of the practitioner, regulation of the practice, it started with 1970 with that act, and for homeopathy, it started with the Homeopathy Center Council. So from 1970, then next, if you see, just before the setting up of the Center Council of Indian Medicine, the government of India, they also set up this Central Council for Research in Indian Systems of Medicine and Homeopathy. So that was again the inclusive policy for IH, because at that point of time there was no body to undertake research activities in IH. So that body was set up, and just after 7 or 8 years there was a thought that why not to have separate research bodies. So then CCRS, it was set up in 1979. CCRS came in 2002, 2004, but the Homeopathic Research Council, Yoga and Naturopathy Research Council, and then the Unani Unani Research Council and the Ayurveda Research Council, and the and Siddha also, that was part of the CCRS at that point. So this prevailed up to 1983. So in the 1983, there was integrated policy support. And if you see the National Health Policy 1983, very categorically it was stated in that policy that there will be integration of Indian systems of medicine and homeopathy in the national healthcare delivery system and in the national healthcare program. But I am frank enough to say that practically nothing happened in the form of any integration. Nothing happened. It happened only in 1995, when this Department of Indian Systems of Medicine and Homeopathy, it was created. So another, this was another inclusive policy support for Ayush system. From 1995, during this, when this integrated policy support was there, because this Department of Indian System of Medicine and Homeopathy, it was under the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. So by virtue of that, by virtue of being the part of Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, the integrated policy support that was provided for the growth and the development of the system. And if you see, if you go back, you might have seen that many national institutions were created during this period. National institutions were, and the research council, they were strengthened. And then in 2014, when the new government came, there was an exclusive policy support. And this exclusive policy support, it culminated into the form of setting up a separate Ministry of Health, so that exclusive opportunities could be given for the growth and development of Ayurveda, Siddha, Unani, Homeopathy, and other. So that was exclusive policy support. So the nature of policy support that has been changing right from the beginning, but the support has been there. And if you see, when I say that policy, so under policy, the five things are important. The five things are important, which need to be regulated. The quality control of those things is required. So for that, we need to make the regulation. We need to make certain laws or like that. And this started with practice. The first is practitioner. So the educational course curricula, they were standardized. So initially there were so many qualifications. Some were 4-year degree course, some were diploma, and the nomenclature of the courses were also different. Somewhere it was AMBS, somewhere it was BIMS, somewhere GMS or like that. So that standardization happened when this Indian Central Council of Indian Medicine was set up. So with that standardization. So standardization of the curricula means the practitioner was standardized. Means what should be the basic qualification to become a practitioner of that system. Then the practice, simultaneously practice. Then the product. As I told you, that the product regulation, it started in 1964. Product regulation for Ayurveda, Siddha, Unani, it started in 1964 when this exclusive definition of Ayurveda, Siddha, Unani, it was given under chapter 4A. There the provisions were there. This chapter was inserted in it. So that. But after that, if you see what has happened, now there is the provisioning of the services. Now a lot of dispensaries, hospitals, and all that happened because of the support from the government, not only from the central government, but also from the state government. And if you see, the most of the hospital dispensaries, they were set up between 1970 to 1990. Abhi jo hai government jo hai, wo jada government hospitals nahi khul rahe hain, dispensary nahi khul rahi hain, private colleges bhi government colleges bhi nahi khul rahe hain. Other private sector, and presently the situation is that 75% of our infrastructure that is in private sector. It is only 25% which is catered by the government, and under this the two flagship programs of the government of India, one this National Ayush Mission and the National Health Mission, this integration means creation of Ayush facilities within the government health network, means the government has done this PSA, CSA, district hospital. So that kind of physical integration that is happening under one roof, but still our policy has not been able to promote functional integration. Functional integration is not there. It is only the physical integration. We are sitting under one roof, but again, we are working in silos. We are working independently or we are working. So functional integration, I think that is the key. That is the key for success in health sector. For getting to the health needs of the people, I think the functional integration is that. And if you can imagine what kind of situation we are facing during this COVID-19 outbreak. There are no proven medicines. What we have medicines, but our medicines, they are not acceptable to the medical fraternity. They are not acceptable to the scientific fraternity. But this situation has provided a lot of opportunity for Ayush, for Ayurveda to prove it. So that is why this task force was created. Many scientific studies they are undergoing in different institutions. So all this is happening because of the policy. Now, based on this, how are this happening? Now, I just want to give one small presentation to you. So if you see the policy framework for Ayush, the first policy statement, it came in 1983, that is the integration of Ayush and in the healthcare delivery system. Then the same policy, when it was revised in 2002, I was also part of that dialogue because our secretary at that point of time was Madam Shailja Chandra. She was the secretary. So when there was a meeting in the chamber of the health minister, so it was suggested that why not to have a separate policy? Why not to have a separate policy for Ayush system? So I was also involved in that, and then we carved out this national policy on Indian system of medicine in 2002. It is still continuing because after that, this policy has not been revised. But the new elements of the policy related to Ayush, those have come in the National Health Policy 2017. And if you see the National Health Policy 2017, it talks about integration of Ayush at all levels, primary healthcare level, secondary healthcare level, tertiary healthcare level, and in the national healthcare programs. So the policy support is there, but somewhere we are not having the enabling framework for implementing the objectives of the policies. Enabling frameworks are not there. You might have seen that like in the national health programs, not even a single Ayush intervention or Ayush drug is included in the national health program. So physical integration is happening in the form of this co-location of Ayush facilities in the PSC, CSC, district hospital, or in other hospitals. But the functional integration, that is not happening. So I think this pharmacy area is one area, I think, where we can have a lot of functional integration. We can have interdisciplinary experts. We can induce interdisciplinary knowledge to the learners of pharmacy, to the students of pharmacy, Ayush pharmacy. So interdisciplinary knowledge of pharmacy can be given, can be imparted to them, and then they can deliver the thing. And if you see the national strategies for Ayush, the focus is on standardization and quality control. Standardization and quality control in every aspect, whether it is practice, whether it is product, whether it is practitioner, whether it is education, so in all aspects. So that is why this policy is always evolving. And it is going strong and strong. And recently, I think just 4 or 5 months back, there is a bill in the parliament, I think because of lockdown, when the parliament was withdrawn, otherwise that bill would have been passed by now, that is National Commission of Indian Medicine, similarly National Commission for Homeopathy. So means just to replace the CCIM, Indian Medicine Center Council. So similarly, means the lot of trust has been given for standardization and quality control. And this is one area, the standardization and quality control of pharmacy education and pharmacy profession. So this third is there. This is also part of the strategy. And the laws, I think everybody knows that how the drugs are regulated in our country. So mainly one particular law, Drugs and Cosmetic Act 1940 is there. And these are the two laws. Another is related to drug information, means how the drug information is to be regulated. One is drugs as such, means manufacturing, sale, distribution, and then the post-market surveillance. So that aspects they are covered under Drugs and Cosmetics Act. And the other is how to control, how to regulate or the drug infection. Right? We pass on to the public through advertising. So that is also important. I think India is one country where we are having two different acts. But in other countries, there is always one act. Even the drug information, that is also regulated by the same act, drug information. So Drugs and Magic Remedies Act, this is the act for controlling the dissemination of drug information. And if you see the drugs, regulated category of drugs and the Drugs and Cosmetic Act, we have pharmaceutical drugs, Ayurveda Siddha Yunani drugs, homeopathy drugs, and phytopharmaceuticals. And all these four categories, they have mutually exclusive provisions. Their provisions, they are not encroaching upon each other. They are exclusive. So that is why the authorities in the states, the regulators, they are also different. The body may be common, like FDA may be common, but the officers, the regulators, the regulatory inspector, and then the licensing authorities, they are different. Because there are exclusive provisions. Now, other acts, I think Mr. Rajiv Puranik, he has elaborated through many other things, many other acts. They are also related with the regulation of Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani, and Homeopathy. So, what is the need for the regulation, drug regulation? So, when I say drug regulation, it is also related with manufacturing. Means the pharmacy aspect also. Why these are needed? To prescribe and enforce standards for the raw materials, for the manufacturing of the drugs, for the labeling, for the distribution, for the sale, for the post-market surveillance, and for the dissemination of the drug information. For all of these things, the regulations are required. But before laying down the regulations, before conceptualizing the regulations, we need to have standards. Otherwise, what we will regulate? So so regulation, they are always dependent on standards. So once we have the standards, then to ensure availability of quality assured drugs and drug information to the people, this is also one of the objectives of the regulation, and to promote public protection from hazards and harmful effects of the drug. I think that is why this pharmacobusiness program that has been conceptualized, that if some drug comes out to be producing certain adverse drug reactions, so some regulatory action could be taken. So that is also part of the regulation. And if you see, why I'm telling this, now we are in the process of having one pharmacy bill, pharmacy council bill, and this bill was conceptualized long back in 2002-2003. I will tell you the story later at what position we are today. But whatever we are going to have in these regulations, there would be five different kinds of provisions. Firstly, enabling provisions. Enabling provisions means what can be done, how should be done. So means the framework of implementing anything. So that is the enabling provision. Then what you cannot do? What you cannot do, that is the prohibitive provision. Right? Like in case of Drugs and Magic Remedies Act, there is a list of 53 disease conditions on which you cannot make a claim. So that is a prohibitive provision. So similarly, these kinds of provisions are seen in every act. So for the pharmacy also, there would be certain prohibitive provisions also. Then the penal provision. If you do the things which you are not expected to do, and the things which are prohibited, if you do those, it means you are violating the law. So for that, the penal provision. So these kind of things are normally seen in all acts. Then the empowering provision. These empowering provisions, like inspector, the drug inspector only can visit the pharmaceutical unit. He can do the inspection because he's authorized. So that is empowering provision. Similarly, only the central government can make the rule. Only the central government can give the direction to the state government. So that is empowering provision. So that is always included in the act. So when the provisions are made, different regulatory provisions are made, then certain powers are also given to the different authorities. So those provisions, they are in public provision. And then exemption provision. Sometimes certain provisions, they need to be exempted. Like in case of labeling provision, So if the product is export oriented, you can make that label as per the requirements of the importing country. But that product will not come to the Indian market. So that kind of exemption provisions are also there. So just for the understanding of the students need and the faculty here, those who are working in this LLC group. So that is now if you see the regulatory provisions in our act for Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani, Homeopathic Act, these are very compact, very few provisions are there. So in Drugs and Cosmetic Act, under Section 3A and Section 3H1, the definition of classical and the definition of proprietary medicines are given. And then in Chapter 4A, from Section 33B to 33O, so 17 sections are there. It talks about what is Miscellaneous Drug, what is the Drug Technical Advisory Board, all those things are there. And there is only one schedule, that is the first schedule, in which the list of authority books means the material which you are going to use in manufacturing Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani product or the formulation. It has to be from that, from those books. Nothing out of that. It means like this ginseng. Now, ginseng is not documented in any of the authority books. It is not documented in any of the authority. It means from ginseng, you cannot make a product in the name of Ayurveda product. Similarly, there might be certain plants which might be growing in the backyard of your house. But if those plants, if they are not documented in the authority books, it means from that plant, and we are facing this problem. We are facing this problem, like soybean. No, soybean, nai. Nai is one plant that is very commonly used in the folklore, and a lot of work, scientific work has been done by our scientists on many medicine plants. But those plants, they are not documented. So all that knowledge, all that scientific knowledge which has been generated, that is kept in the almanac. There is no translational value of that knowledge because the product is not there in the market. So only the scientists, they have taken the patent. But the product is not there because they are not fitting into the root of Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani product. So our CSIR scientists, ICMR scientists, or the DBT scientists, they have done a lot of work on many medicine plants. But they have published papers, they have taken patents, and again, those patents and those, they are in the almanac. Industry is not using that knowledge because the provisions are not there. So we are now, the government of India, they have set up a committee for making regulatory reforms. I am also a member of that committee, and we would take care of that the new medicine plants could be included. So we want to broaden the definition of Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani. It may be for proprietary medicines at least, but the classical formulations we cannot change. We cannot say, because if we tamper with the classical formulation, it means we will lose the sanctity of our formulation. So that we are not going to do, but our intention is that the more medicine plants and the dosage form, the new dosage form, the new drug delivery system, those could be included within the definition of that Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani. Now, if you see the Drugs and Cosmetic Act, on the second schedule, clause 4A, it talks about standards of homeopathic drug. There is no definition of homeopathic drug. The definition of homeopathic drug is only given in the rules. And if you see the operational part of the act, operational part of the act is rules. Because the implementation of the act is done through the rules. So if you see the rules, rule 151 to 170, they are meant for regulation of Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani drugs. And rule 30AA, rule 67, rule 85, A to L, and rule 106A, they are meant for homeopathic drugs. So whether it is manufacturing, whether it is for sale, because sale license is required for homeopathic medicine, it is not there in on Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani side. So as the apprehension of Mr. Puranik that the sale license for Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani, as an expert and as a policymaker in the government, I am of the view that that sale means sale license. We are not. I am not in favor of sale license. I am saying that only the registration of the seller. A registration of the seller. At least we should come to know that, okay, who are selling these products? Who are selling these products? just like a practitioner, he can do any kind of practice, but he is a registered. After registration only, he can start the practice. So similarly, we are saying that whosoever, whatever his qualification may be, he can lay down that, okay, oh, only matriculate could be there, or a 10 plus 2 pass. Whosoever is selling Ayurveda, Siddha, Unani medicine, I think he must be registered. He must be registered. So only then good selling practices, their guidelines can be made. Then good storage practices in the retail outlets, those can be made. So presently, the thing is there. So sale license, that is not the concept in our mind, but we want that seller, whosoever is the seller, he must be registered, and the kind of products which will need a prescription, that also needs to be isolated. That needs to be kept. That means all the products cannot be OTC products. All the products cannot be the self-help care products. Right? If on one hand we are having this schedule E1 and there is a list of 57 poisonous substances, it means the poisonous substances, these are the ingredients of the Ayurveda, Siddha, Unani medicine, particularly the proprietary. Because in case of proprietary, there is no type tested evidence of safety. If Smirpana grass is there, okay, it is a classical formulation, time tested efficacy and safety is there. If the quality standards of that product as given, as prescribed in the authority books, if those are maintained, okay, that could be safe and that could be safe, right? But in case of new formulation, then we, on one hand, we are saying that if you mix honey and ghee in equal proportion, it becomes poison. Then what about those drugs which are already poisonous? So the evidence of safety that is required in proprietary medicine, those who are having schedule even ingredients, any of the schedule even, whether it is of animal origin or plant origin or mineral origin or marine origin. So that's it. So in case of Ayurveda, Siddha, Unani drugs, the rules pertaining to these drugs are rule 151 to 170, and there is schedule E1. Schedule E1, it provides the list of those poisonous substances for which the caution has to be mentioned on the label of that formulation. That, okay, to be taken under medical supervision. Now, there is a thought that we will enhance this provision. We will say that to be consumed under medical prescription. Presently, it is only for the consumer. But means the selling also means that this kind of product should not be sold without prescription. In India, we are getting informal reports that this is happening. But we are getting formal reports from the foreign country, from USA, from Canada, from Europe. We are getting a lot of complaints that, okay, this product has heavy metals more than this permissible limit. So to them, we respond that, okay, these heavy metals don't go by the title of the heavy metal present in that formulation. But according to us, it is a classical formulation, it is a time-tested formulation, it is mentioned in the formulary, it is mentioned in the pharmacopoeia, and it is a special category, right? Rashashni are the special categories of Ayurveda, Siddha, Unani medicine. So it is not the mere presence, high presence of heavy metal or some other poisonous material. But we also say that certain pharmaceutical processes are applied on that product, like Shodhana, Marana, Amritikarana, then these are rendered therapeutically safe and therapeutically effective. So that is important. But whether this process has been done on that product or not, how to ensure that? How to check that? This is the question. This is the regulatory challenge. We might be saying that, okay, Shodhana has been done on this product, Marana has been done, but whether it was done or not, how to check it, even for the classical medicine. So there are limitations of the analytical technology. There are limitations of it. Means by available analytical technology, we can say that, okay, this much amount of heavy metal is present in the formulation, but we cannot detect the nature of the heavy metal. Because we have done the transformation of the nature of that heavy metal. So that is why our mercurial formulation, they are safe. They are effective. Even if the mercury is there. So sanskaro hi gunam pradhanam. Professor Chaudhary knows very well. Right? So this is the regulatory challenge. Means when we are saying that okay, Nirbhandagra is in the market, so means how to test it? How to test it? Testing the safety. Means without consuming. After consuming, you can test, but without consuming, means a product which is picked up from the market, that is, right? Then, if you see in the drugs and cosmetic routes for homeopathy, and then the drugs and magic remedies that all of you know that there are a very small act, hardly of 4 pages, and then under that there is a small rules are there, and the objective is just for three things. One is there are certain diseases, 57 disease conditions. And I am also very convinced that there are certain conditions or health conditions or the disorders which are the potential areas of Ayush, like liver disease. The simple fever is there. So a committee has been set up in the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. I am also a member of that committee, interdepartmental committee, that is for this drugs and medical remedy, for the amendment of the drug. And we have suggested that this list may be, this a list of diseases should be repealed. It should be repeated. So advertisement should be on the basis of the claim, on the claim, not on the basis of the disease. So because otherwise there are many problems our industry is facing in advertising certain products. So that kind of suggestion we have given to that. And now if you see in nutshell, the whole regulatory framework in our country, the central government has the powers to make and amend the regulatory provisions. Then central government has the power to give directions to the state governments, to the state authorities. Then central government has set up Pharmacopoeia Commission of Indian Medicine and Homeopathy and the Pharmacopoeia Committee for the development of the standards, for the development of the SOPs. Then the central laboratories are there. So, and then now we are going to have a central regulatory framework for Ayurveda, Siddha, Unani and Homeopathy drugs. And the nine regulatory posts have been created, and their recruitment rules, they are just at the verge of finalization and approval by the law ministry. And once these are finalized and approved, we will issue the notification of the recruitment rules, and then we will start the recruitment process. I think within this year, this will happen. So with that, there will be a proper coordination between the state and the center. Because presently, there is only a small cell in the ministry that is known as drug control cell. Now it is named as drugs policy section. Only 4 or 5 people are there. But now this Ayush vertical, this is going to be set up and it is going to work under the supervision overall control of the drug controller general of India. So Ayush vertical in the CDSCO that has already been created, and that was created in 2018. On 5th February 2018, that presently there is no incumbent in there, and the officers of the Ministry of Additional Charge, I just like I am also working as a district controller for Ayush. I'm working as a. So, all the files from the CDSCO, like for WHO GMP certification or for other, they come to us and we give the. But once we have these regulatory posts filled up, means the 9 persons, 4 drug inspectors, 4 assistant drug controllers, and 1 the deputy drug controller for Ayush. So all these posts, I think by 31st March 2021, we will try to fill up these posts, and then these will be there. And then we are also providing financial support to the National Ayush Mission for improving the quality control mechanism, for improving the regulatory framework in the state. We are also providing support for the testing of the medicines, for strengthening of the pharmacy, but it is only limited to government pharmacy, government drug testing laboratories. And I think many of you might not be aware that under drugs and cosmetic rules, as on date, 59 laboratories in the country, they are recognized, they are approved, and they work as just public laboratories, government laboratories. So private laboratories, they are recognized under the provisions of the rule 160 of the drugs and cosmetic rules. So there is a mechanism of joint inspection. The inspectors from the state side and the inspectors from the central government, they visit, and then the approval is not easy. It takes around 6 months. The application by the laboratory people, that is made to the state licensing authority, then the state licensing authority, they examine the documents, inspect of infrastructure, inspect of the distribution of different sections of the laboratory, the manpower, the reference standards, the books, and the testing manuals, all those things. Then they make the proposal to the central government that, okay, and now this whole exercise is complete, application is complete, all the documents are complete, a joint inspection could be made. So then the central inspector and the state inspector, they make the inspection and they give the report. On the basis of that report, either the application is rejected or accepted and this recognition or approval is given and the license is given. So as on date, 59 laboratories in the country, they are recognized. And if you see on the state side, the role of the state government is just to enforce the provisions, not to make any provisions, not to make any rules. The rules are made by the central government. The regulatory provisions, they are made by the central government. So in case of act, it is done with the approval of the parliament. And in case of rules, it is made by a consultative process. It is done by the ministry. And for homeopathy medicines, it is done by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, because the homeopathic medicines, they are still under the control of Drug Technical Advisory Board, which is under the Drug Controller General of India. Right? It is not with the ministry, but in case of Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani, Drug Technical Advisory Board, we place that. Now we have made a proposal to the government, and this has been agreed that even the homeopathy medicines, their issues, their technical matters, their policy matters, their regulatory matters will also be considered by the Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani, Drug Technical Advisory Board. And we have set up a committee of homeopathy experts. And on the basis of recommendations of that committee, the homeopathy drug related issues that will also be considered by the Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani, Drug Technical Advisory Board. And just last week, we have written to the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare that all notifications related to homeopathy drugs, that should also be issued by the Ministry of Ayush, because when all the other things related to homeopathy are controlled by the Ministry of Ayush, I think it should not be with some other institution like the Ministry of Health or DCGI. And why we have said that? Because soon we are going to have our regulatory offices, regulatory posts filled up in the CDSCO. So at the state government level, state government is responsible to enforce the legal provisions, whether it is the provisions of that, or whether the provisions of the rules all have to be enforced by the state government. And for that purpose, they appoint licensing authority, they appoint drug controllers, they appoint drug inspectors. But unfortunately, if you see the number of inspectors in the country for Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani and homeopathy, it is very, very negligible. Very, very negligible. I think even on the allopathic side, the number of inspectors, that is very less, very less. If you see the structure, regulatory structure of Health Canada, in the Health Canada, in the natural plant division, natural product division of Health Canada. Health Canada is the regulatory body in the Ministry of Health there in Canada. 2,000 inspectors are there. I think we don't have 2,000 across the country, including Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani, homeopathic inspectors and Ayurveda. We don't have 2,000. So this is the situation. And most of the work that is additional responsibility, even to the licensing authority. The state directors, they are the licensing authority. The inspectors, the district officers, without any training, without any orientation, they have been given this regulatory responsibility. This is, I think this is really unfortunate. And I think that is one of the problems that why these regulations, they are not enforced. So there is a problem with the enforcement of the standard also. Because now in big states, like in Karnataka, I think 700, 584 or 600 manufacturing units are there. Only two inspectors are there. So one inspector is sitting in the headquarter and one in the field. Now, the person in the field, he usually go to more times to the court than to the manufacturing unit. So this is a problem. So we need regulatory manpower, more and more regulatory manpower. And I think once we have this trained manpower from the pharmacy side, pharmacists, pharmacy experts, B Pharma or M Pharma, I think that gap is going to be bridged. Then the drug testing laboratory, this is the responsibility of the state government to set up a drug testing laboratory. 27 drug testing laboratories have been set up by the state government in the country. And apart from that, we have also given direction to the state government that if you don't have the state or the government laboratory, at least you must have some laboratory which is recognized as a Dagger property. So 59 laboratories are there in the country, but they are not evenly distributed. Many of the states, they still do not have any laboratory, either their own laboratory or any private laboratory. Then the approval and the licensing of the drug testing laboratory is also done by the state government, but with the conference or with the approval of the state central authority. Then you might be thinking that how these rules are made, how the regulatory provisions are made. The government itself does not make any rules, but on the advice of, if there is a statutory body, Ayurveda Siddha Yunani Drug Technical Advisory Board. Similarly, there is Ayurveda Siddha Yunani Drugs Consultative Committee. These are the two statutory bodies under the provision of the Drugs and Cosmetic Act, which advise the central government that, okay, what kind of regulatory provisions are required? What kind of standards are required? So accordingly, that recommendation is given to the Pharmacopoeia Committee, that is given to the Pharmacopoeia Commission, and then they develop the standards accordingly. And those kinds of things are then imposed, and then they are brought in the rules, and then those are notified, and then those are enforced. So drug consultative committee and Ayurveda Siddha Yunani Drug Technical Advisory Board, these are the two statutory bodies to give advice to the central government as well as to the state government. For the state government, it is for the purpose of enforcement, but to the central government, for the purpose of making the regulation or amending the regulation. So that advice is given for technical matters, for the policy matters, as well as for the enforcement issues. That advice is given to the central government. And then for homeopathy, as I told you, there was a small committee of subcommittee of homeopathy. Now this subcommittee has been repealed. Now we have an expert committee of homeopathy, and that has been set up by the Ministry of Health, and that committee is going to report to the Ayurveda Siddha Yunani Drug Technical Advisory Board, means that it will be under the control of the Ministry of Health. So this is the overall regulatory framework in our country. Now, soon, I think within a year, I am expecting that within a year, we are going to have, within this regulatory framework, some framework for pharmacy education and pharmacy profession. So that is also going to be the part of this framework. Now, we have also some certification systems, quality certification systems for the products. Because these systems, these are required because to have the credible products in the market and to facilitate the export of products. So as Mr. Ranjit Puranik told you all, that since 2002, our GMP provisions, those have not been revised, those not have been amended, or those not have been augmented. So we set up a committee about 1.5 years back. So that committee, the report has come there, and that is for the enhancement of the provisions of the GMP to make it comparable with the WHO GMP, or to make it comparable with the Schedule M of the allopathic side. And presently, there is another WHO certification system is there, that is WHO GMP and COPD system. Very interesting thing has happened in this area. So previously, there was no WHO GMP manufacturing unit of Ayurveda Siddha Yunani. So in 2010, when I was in, I got the opportunity to work in WHO system. So I proposed this idea that let us have WHO GMP and COPP system for our Ayurveda Siddha Yunani products and manufacturing units. And we had series of consultations with that DCGI, because DCGI is the implementer of this scheme. They are implementing this scheme. They are administering this scheme. So at that point of time, I think Mr. Rajiv Pranik is aware of that thing. Mr. Shiv Basant was our joint secretary, and he agreed, and we pushed it. And soon, I think just at the beginning of 2011, we started this WHO GMP and COPP system for Ayurveda Siddha Yunani. And now I am happy that in the last 10 years, today, as on today, 23 Ayurveda companies, they are WHO GMP. And they are exporting to more than 105 countries. Because many of the countries, even small countries like Nepal, Bangladesh, they are also asking for this COPP. They are also looking for COPP, means certification of pharmaceutical product. this WHO GMP is a global system. So the country, whoever has adopted this system, so once you get the stamp that, okay, this company WHO GMP certified, and from the WHO GMP certified manufacturing unit, if this product is certified as a pharmaceutical product, it means no other check and balance is required. No other check is required. That single certificate is sufficient. No other certificate is required for the importing country. So this is the thing. So this is a very, very facilitatory system for export of products, particularly if the products are to go to other countries as health products. Health products. the fact of the matter is that our products are manufactured in our country under the provisions of the Drug Act. But our products, hardly they are going as drugs. They are going as either food supplement, dietary supplements, or OTC health products or like that. Because unless they fit into the regulatory requirements of the importing country, they cannot be exported. So the intended use of the product, it changes. The same is not the case of allopathic drugs. But in our case, for Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani drug, we say it's a drug, but practically for the purpose of export, it is not a drug. Because as drug, it does not fit into the definition of drug. Because the regulatory provisions there in the importing country, they are very stingy. We fail to provide the complete dossier of the product as a drug. So that is why our products, they are going either food supplement, either dietary supplements, or other normal health products, OTC products. Sometimes I've been surprised. Just 1.5 years back, I got an invitation from Doha government, from Qatar government, that you must impart training to our officers, regulatory officers, because they are not aware of what Ayurveda drugs are, Ayurveda products are. Because many of the products, Ayurveda products and the homeopathic products, they were flooded in the Qatar market. So how to check the quality? How to regulate that? So I went there on the recommendation of the WHO, and we imparted a 3 days training to 20 officers there, and right from 8 a.m. to 3 p.m. And when they saw our regulations, they said, "Your regulations are perfect." Said, "Our regulations are perfect, but the enforcement is not perfect. Enforcement is not perfect." So now they are in the process of making their regulations as per our regulation, and that will help in the export of our products. Now, in UAE, more than 450 Ayush doctors, they are practicing there. I had a meeting with those practitioners, from where you are getting the medicine. So two, three practitioners, they stood up, and one told me that not even a single Yunani medicine is registered in UAE. Not even a single. So, then how you are managing? How you are managing your patients? There is a provision in the UAE regulation that even the herb, if it is registered, so that herb can be prescribed. And if you are prescribing that herb, which is registered for market authorization, for sale, it means you will get the insurance reimbursement also. So they are surviving, they are doing their practice just on the basis of the herbs which are available in the UAE market. And same thing with other Ayurveda formulations. Also, Ayurveda practitioners, they simply prescribe the herbs, and those in UAE, the herb is registered, the formulation is registered, the seller is registered, and the practitioner is registered. So if the registered practitioner make a prescription of a product which is already registered, then you can get the insurance coverage. Otherwise not. And you cannot prescribe a product which is not registered yet. So their rules and regulations are very clear, very simple, straightforward. So UAE, Middle Eastern countries, and the other neighboring countries, Central Asian countries, I think these are the virgin land for Ayurveda, Siddha, I think Ayurveda, Siddha, Unani must penetrate that market, must penetrate. But for that, we need our manufacturers, our exporters, they need to produce the dossiers as per their requirement. So that is not happening. After coming back from Qatar, I had a meeting with the United Manufacturers, and Mumbai also, we had one WTGM workshop in the month of January. There also, there is a lot of opportunities are there. Now, I think with this pharmacy experts, I think all these issues, these can be addressed when we have the training. Another voluntary certification system, that is this QCI, as Mr. Ranjit Pranik also pointed out, that is IUSH standard mark and IUSH premium mark. But all these are voluntary. And there are other ISO certification systems for the process, and there are so many other systems that are out there. And if you see the export value of our traditional medicine, it is hardly, we got the same information from the PharmExil. It is $111 US million dollars in 2015-16, and products, not the raw material. And 2016-17, it was 123 and then 144 US million dollars. But our products, they are going in different categories, no, as Ayush medicine products. So this export value, it can be enhanced to a large extent. It can be enhanced to a large extent. And for medicine plant material, I think India is number one in the export of the medicine plant material. Previously, 10 years back, 7 years back, it was at number seven. So after this efforts of the National Medicine Plant Board and all this cultivation of the medicine plant on large scale, commercial scale, that has started happening. So with that good quality raw material that is going out of it. Our domestic industry, because presently hardly 20% of the material that is coming from the cultivation. 75 to 80% is still coming from the wild, from the forest. So again, there is a challenge to the quality of the material, because that is coming from different places, different harvesting time, different storage practices, and then the transport practices. So we are facing many problems. Our industry is facing many problems, particularly this quality raw material. And we are trying to address through policy interventions like this Biological Diversity Act. Now, in the Biological Diversity Act, it is very difficult to use the bioresources. You will have to pay this ABS, access and benefit sharing, to make the use of these bioresources. So, for the last more than 50 years, we are grappling with this issue, and we have taken up matters with the Ministry of Environment, Forest, and National Biodiversity Board. And I think there is a direction that there are some changes will be made in the National Biological Diversity Act, as well as the rule. I think that could be most suitable. So, friends, this is the thing, and if you see the background of the standardization and the regulation of Ayurveda, Siddha, Unani, that, as I told you, that the first Pharmacopoeia Committee was set up in 1962, then in 1964, the Unani Pharmacopoeia Committee, Siddha Pharmacopoeia Committee, first time it was set up in 1975, and then Homeopathy Pharmacopoeia Committee. And these are the standard setting bodies, just for the information of all the participants here, that the Pharmacopoeia Laboratory for Indian Medicine, it was set up in 1975, and then Homeopathy Pharmacopoeia Laboratory. Initially, these laboratories were set up for setting the standard. These were not the regulatory laboratories. These were the pharmacopoeia standard setting body. But later on, these laboratories were incorporated in the drugs and cosmetic rule, and these were notified as the affiliate laboratories. Now, these laboratories have become part of the Pharmacopoeia Commission for Indian Medicine now. Since 3rd June 2020, when the cabinet accorded approval to this new structure, that Pharmacopoeia Commission of Indian Medicine and Homeopathy will be the subordinate office of the ministry. Previously, it was autonomous. Now, it is part of the ministry. It is a subordinate office of the ministry, and I think you will see many new changes in the functioning and many new changes in meeting the objectives of the Pharmacopoeia Commission. And we will try to go with the global trends. We will try to harmonize our standards with the global standards so that our products they can penetrate the international market. These are the standards published so far. Now the difficult part is that whatever we are doing, we have very less expertise, and we are not going to take any input from outside. Because if we are developing standards for Ayurveda drugs, it means we have to do only, not the other person. Whereas in the allopathic side, the whole world is working. Whole world is working, right? Means even the countries where the Ayurveda is practiced, like Sri Lanka, they are also reliant on our pharmacopoeia. They don't have their own pharmacopoeia. In Nepal also, in Bangladesh also. So this is the thing. So means everything we have to do, we know from zero to Z, we have to do everything. So that is why to develop one standard of one drug, it takes around 1 year. 1 year. And sometimes there are so many contradictory data, it becomes very difficult to fix the standard. So the pharmacopoeia committee or the higher body, they do not agree, and then standards are not. So till date only, you just see 202 formulations. Their standards are given in part two of the pharmacopoeia. And 645 single drugs, their standards are given in the Ayurvedic pharmacopoeia part one. Whereas we say that, okay, we have around 1200 medicinal plants which are commonly used in Ayurveda. Our industry is using, I think, around 1200 medicinal plants. But if you see the standards, so in that case, what to do? You have to be your in-house standard. But who will prepare the in-house standards? Again, the pharmacy experts are there. Because if they are working in the manufacturing units, if they are working in the quality control institutions, so only then they will help in developing those in-house standards in the same template, in the same format as we have for the other drugs in the pharmacopoeia. So this is the situation, and this is the background of pharmacy profession. I think very rightly pointed out by Mr. Ranjit Puranik, that initially practitioner, he was oriented in always. वो जो है वो जीएससीपी का भी कंप्लाइंट था, गुड एग्रीकल्चर प्रैक्टिस को मालूम था कि कौन सी जड़ी बूटी जो है कब जो है उसको हार्वेस्ट करना है, कैसे उसको रखना है, कैसे उससे दवाई बनानी है, तो जीएमपी कंप्लाइंस वगैरह सब कुछ वही करता था. तो मीन्स इट वॉज ए फर्स्ट पार्टी कंप्लाइंस, सब कुछ वही करता था. एवरीथिंग रिलेटेड टू प्रिस्क्रिप्शन, रिलेटेड टू प्रिपरेशन ऑफ द ड्रग, हार्वेस्टिंग ऑफ द इंग्रीडियंट and storing of the ingredient, how to prepare them, everything used to be done by the practitioner. So there was a vaidya patient direct relation. Now, then after some time, as Dr. Chaudhary pointed out, that it was only in the concept of this pharmacy, it was initially came in Charangdar Singh. Very true, it is very true. Followed by practice second party oriented, means if you see the symptomatic treatment, I think it is for the first time it is there in Charangdar Sainta and Yog Ratnakar. Previously it was not there. It was only Siddhantik Chikitsa. So that helped this Vaidya and other Vaidya. One Vaidya used to prepare the medicine, he used to give it to other Vaidya or to the other healthcare facility. Jaise maan lo ek ko king hai, aur us king ne jo hai koi wahan pe ek health center banaya. From where the medicine will come? So, ये third party वाला जो concept है, ये काफी बाद में आया. I think it came in late 18th century and early 19th century. So then the commerce and trade oriented third party sale and marketing started. So then the regulation. When the things are in the third party hands, so we need to regulate the thing. So the regulation is there. But still. We don't have any regulations for this pharmacy education and the pharmacy profession, but we are working on that. And the emerging scenario, as Mr. Puranik I think emphasized from the perspective of industry, that R&D is required. We need to adopt global technologies. If we want to globalize our traditional knowledge, we have to adopt the global technology. So localization of the global technology and globalization of the local health technology. I think that should be the tagline with which we should move forward. So R&D and international trends oriented approach, that is the emerging scenario. And for that, the practitioner, the practice, the product manufacturers, right? It is regulated. So far, it is regulated. But the pharmacy profession, practice of Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani, and homeopathy, the pharmacy practice, it is not regulated. Not regulated. Be that the university level or by some other bodies like AICT or other NEPC, why is this long standing need for this? Because we need trained pharmacy manpower for the teaching institution. We don't have pharmacy experts in our Ayurveda college. Even in the Pharmacopeia Commission, when I took over the charge of director there, I was surprised. I say we are working for the standard. We don't have the pharmacy officer here. So now I have made a proposal that there at least 2-3 pharmacy experts should be there, M Pharma or B Pharma for Ayurveda side, from homeopathy side. So teaching institution, we need pharmacists, need the pharmacy experts for hospital dispensing, whether in the government sector or in the private sector, who are giving medicine, who are mixing the medicine, how those medicines are cut. Stored or kept, we don't know, right? Because without any formal institutional training, they have been given the responsibility to put the medicine. Then for innovation, for research and development, for new doses form, for adoption of contemporary drug delivery system, and for adoption of new technology, who will help us out on the trained pharmacy manpower? And for manufacturing also, for quality control also. So presently, if you see the GMP, the provisions for Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani, the two persons are required. One for the production side and one for the quality control side. Many of the manufacturing, they are not aware of this. They are having only one person. So he doing the job, doing the production also, and the same person is certifying that, okay, it is okay. So judge and jury is same. So performer and the judge, same. Right? So this is it. So we need two persons in the manufacturing units. So one on the production side, under whose supervision the manufacturing will be done, and one that product is manufactured, then that product will go to the quality control for quality check. Right? But presently, only for the name of that, okay, one person is there only. But as per even our regulatory officer, even our inspectors, they are not aware of it. So lot of regulatory ignorance is there. We are not well versed with the regulatory provision. What is there in the rule? What is there in the regulatory provision? Our stakeholders, they are not aware. So once you are indulged in manufacturing, once you are indulged in the trade of Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani drugs or products, I think first of all, daily I get 2 or 3 phone calls with some reference either from the minister's office or someone that, okay, please guide this person. So when I put the first question, okay, what is your qualification? They say, I am this MBA. Okay, I have this formula and this. Matthew, this is not Ayurveda product. People do not know what is Ayurveda product. What is the legally, how Ayurveda product should be defined? They don't know. These days, I think there is a lot of hue and cry about this hemp products, cannabis products, because a lot of products, they are coming from USA, cannabinoids. They are saying that, okay, give us Ayurveda license. How this cannabinoid can be given Ayurveda license? Unless it fits into the definition of Ayurveda, even definition. And the 4 parameters, which are very important in the drugs and cosmetic rule, that, okay, first is the product must meet the definition of Ayurveda, Siddha. Simple thing. Means either the formulation or the ingredients which you are using in your products, that should be from the fertility. If even a single ingredient of the formulation, if it is not from the authority books, it means you cannot claim that it's there with the product. Cannot. Second requirement is it must meet the standards as given in the formula. Okay. If the standards are not there, you will have to give your enough standards. Third requirement is the proof of safety and effectiveness. The proof of safety and effectiveness, it could be a 3 forms. Either, like, so if you are saying that, okay, it is Prameha, Nisha Amlaki Yog Prameh hai. No problem. You just give the reference that, okay, Nisha Amlaki is mentioned in Charak Sanhita at this page number and this is the indication mentioned. No problem. But if you are saying that Nisha Amlaki is hypoglycemic, no, that authoritative reference will not be sufficient. You will have to give the reference either from the scientific literature or some clinical trial data. Without that, you cannot put that claim that it is hypoglycemic. So that is why if you see the drugs and cosmetic rule 158B, for the classical formulation, there are three requirements. Means classical formulation with classical claims. Okay, no problem. No safety, no. But if it is a new dosage form, like prifraturin is there in the classical books. But prifravati is not there. But if you are saying that, okay, prifravati is allowed as classical. Under 3A, it is allowed. But you will have to give the evidence of its efficacy. Then the new indication. Not just COVID-19, it is a new indication. So for the new indication, the clinical trial is required. The pilot study or clinical study is required. From where you will generate? Because this is not documented already. It is not documented. So all these claims which are coming in the newspapers, in the magazines, and in the social media, that okay, COVID ka bana diya, humne wo bana diya. I think scientific data is required. And secondly, once you say COVID, it means it has to be antiviral. Antiviral, COVID-19 virus. Immunity, if anything is immunity boosting, it does not mean that it is anti-COVID. So these are the things which are required, and now if you see, you just see, I think this point was well tested by Dr. Chaudhary. In our country, we have around 45 institutions which are conducting different kind of pharmacy courses, Ayurveda pharmacy courses. Kahin pe jo hai 6 mahine ka chal raha hai, kahin pe 1 saal ka chal raha hai certificate course, kahin pe diploma chal raha hai 2 saal ka, kahin pe jo hai degree course chal raha hai. डिग्री कोर्स वाली जो है सिर्फ 4-5 इंस्टीट्यूशन है. एक जो है पंजाब में है, एक जैसे बीएचयू का है, एक ये जामनगर का सबसे पुराना है, और एक जो है कल्याणी में जो है वेस्ट बंगाल में है, और शायद एक शायद जयपुर में भी अभी शुरू हुआ है, पर वो दो साल वाला है कोर्स है. तो राजस्थान में जो कोर्स चलते हैं वहाँ पे क्या है कि आप देखिए वहाँ पे लिखा है नर्सिंग एंड कंपाउंडर कोर्स. मैंने उसको भी स्कूल में इंक्लूड किया. यूनानी के जो है देर आर ओनली 3 इंस्टीट्यूशन इन द कंट्री विच आर कंडक्टिंग सम डिप्लोमा कोर्स, और एक तो जामिया अहमदाबाद में है, एक शायद जामिया मिलिया इस्लामिया में, और एक शायद कहीं और है. ठीक है, सिद्धा के हर 2 इंस्टीट्यूशन, होम्योपैथी के 9 इंस्टीट्यूशन, और यहाँ से जो जो एनुअल जो क्या कहते हैं जो आउटकम है, मतलब कितने लोग बाहर आ रहे हैं ट्रेंड जो है, सो कॉल्ड ट्रेंड 2483. सो ओनली 59 इंस्टीट्यूशन आर देयर, एंड मोस्ट ऑफ दीज इंस्टीट्यूशन दे आर कंडक्टिंग ओनली सर्टिफिकेट कोर्स 1 year, Ayurveda pharmacy or Unani pharmacy, like that. So there is lot of diversity, and if you see the contents of the course curriculum, they are also very different. They are not standardized. In case of B Pharma and M Pharma, most of the institutions, means the only 5 are there. They are following each other. Means they are based on their course curriculum. They are based on the course curriculum developed by Jamnagar Institute Pharmaceutical. This is the situation. And we also estimated that how much is the requirement of the pharmacy manpower in the country. We have government hospital 3,903. So at least one hospital we require 2 pharmacy experts. It means 7,886. We have 28,196 government dispensaries in the country. It means at least one pharmacy expert is required in each dispensary. Then we have co-located facility 15,543. So, and I think this figure, now it has reached around 20,000. So 20,000 this is required, because some of the facilities, they are in the hospital. So in the hospital, at least 2 pharmacy experts are required. Then in the teaching hospital, we have around 698. Now the number has gone up to 712. It means 712 teaching hospital, they need pharmacy experts, institutionally qualified, properly trained. Then in the teaching side also, we equal number. But in the teaching hospital, at least 3 pharmacy experts are required, because the round the clock duty in the hospital, morning shift, evening shift, night shift, pharmacy expert. If you see in the allopathic side, means pharmacy expert is also required. Then licensed manufacturing units. So at least 2 persons are required, one on the production side, one on the quality control side. So we have 9,000 licensed manufacturing, and the requirement is just a double. And then the Ayush drug regulatory persons. So at least in each state, in each under each regulatory authority, 10 inspectors are required. So across the country, 350 to 360 those are required minimum. And then in the private sector, we those who are selling. This is the estimate. This is the estimate. So means at least presently we need around 3,27,300 pharmacy experts, those who are properly trained. But what we are doing? We are putting our VMS doctors. We are putting those persons, those who are working with the doctors, and they become the pharmacist or the compounder. Right? So very few people, as Mr. Ranjit Pranik pointed out, that there is no need for the time being to induce this sale license. I fully agree with that. I am also not in favor of that. But we need to know how many sellers are there in the country. How many sellers of Ayurveda, we don't know. Even the pawn shop, you will get an Ayurvedic medicine. So do you think that Ayurveda medicine should be sold from a pawn shop? Can you imagine this? You will get Tripura Churna from there. You will get that Kavach Hargoli. Do you think like that? So there will be different levels of sellers. There will be sellers who are selling prescription products. So definitely there will be a categorization that, okay, who can sell the prescription product, right? So we are not laying down any qualification, but this registration of the selling is required. So that, you know, I am sitting in the ministry for the last 20 years, right? I was a practitioner in CGHS. Now still many senior officers, they come to me. When I give the prescription, their first question is, Dr. Saab, ye dawai kahan se milegi? मतलब उनको ये भी पता नहीं है कि देयर कुड बी आयुर्वेद ड्रग सेलर आज वो कहते कहाँ से मिलेगी और अगर नहीं पूछते हैं तो वो ले जाते हैं अगले दिन फोन आ जाता है डर से भी दवाई तो मिलेगी तो कहने का मतलब है अगर हमें ये मालूम हो कि हु आर द सेलर वी कैन पुट इन द वेबसाइट स्टेट वाइज तो कम से कम जो कंज्यूमर्स हैं लोग हैं उनको पता तो चलेगा कि फ्रॉम दिस शॉप दे कैन परचेज द मेडिसिन आप बताइए जरा बिकॉज ऑफ दिस इग्नोरेंस Many people, they are not switching over to Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani. This is also one of the reasons. Frankly speaking, they might be going to the practitioner, but the practitioner, those who are giving the practice, मेरे पास गुड़गांव के पेशेंट आते हैं, वो बाद में आना बंद कर देते हैं, वो कहते जाते हैं, दवाई नहीं मिलती है, वो कहते हैं, दवाई लेने के लिए हम दिल्ली आएंगे क्या बार बार और अगर मान लो क्या कहते हैं उसको वेबसाइट पे ऑनलाइन जो है ऑर्डर करना है कुछ करना है तो पता तो हो So that is why means my proposition is my thought is that we must go for this registration of the sellers. We can categorize the sellers that okay who could be the prescription product seller and who could be the other one. That can be. And these are the objectives of the intended regulations. And just I tell you that we introduced one bill in 2005 in the parliament that was for regulation of pharmacy education and profession of Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani, Homeopathy. And this was introduced in the parliament in Rajya Sabha on 23rd August 2005. But it was referred to a committee, parliamentary standing committee. And the report of the committee, it came in 2006. And in that report, there were around more than 40-50 comments, observations, some objections, some suggestions. So when we started working on that, in the meantime, there was a conscious decision of the government that we will have only one umbrella regulatory body in the country that was in the name of National Commission for Human Resources in India. And similarly, National Commission for Human Resources in India. I think many of you might be remembering that in 2008-09, this concept was there in mind, but it did not fructify, it did not materialize. So, and this decision, it came quite late. Came in 2013 that okay we will not go for the commission because series of consultations, series of meetings with the parliamentary committee, and it was not agreed. And then in 2013 the government dropped the idea of national commission, and it was decided to withdraw the bill. उस वक्त ये draft ये decide किया कि इसको चलो हम modify करेंगे और नए ढंग से बनाएंगे. Then we started working on a fresh bill, and then And we were advised that, okay, we must consult Pharmacy Council of India. And if the provisions for Ayush pharmacy could be included in the Pharmacy Act 1948, I think that could be a better proposition, because then there would not be any need to set up a new structure, because already the structure is there. Only the elements of Ayush pharmacy, those could be controlled, those could be regulated if we have those provisions. So the Pharmacy Council, they declined. They did not agree. And similarly, the Ministry of Health, the pharmacy division is there. Who controls this Pharmacy Council? So it's not agree. So possibility explored to create a separate Ayush pharmacy board, just like National Council of this National Commission of Indian Medicine. There is a provision of a board. So we suggested to them, we recommended to them that let us have a separate Ayush pharmacy board under this Pharmacy Council of India. So because this area is interdisciplinary, this is not standalone Ayush. It is interdisciplinary area. Pharmacy in Ayush is a interdisciplinary area. So let us have it was not turned on. It was not materialized. So then again we were. So means you just think of me. Means for the last 5-6 years, means this snake is in my neck. वो निकल नहीं रहा. और एवरी टाइम यू गेट न्यू इंस्ट्रक्शंस, न्यू सजेशंस, न्यू ऑब्जेक्शंस, एंड वर्ड बाय वर्ड, लाइन बाय लाइन, वी हैव टू चेंज द होल थिंग. एंड दिस वर्क कैन नॉट बी गिवन टू सम अदर पर्सन, बिकॉज़ पीपल नॉट अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट वाज द व्हाट हैपेंड इन द पास्ट. सो अकॉर्डिंगली रिवाइज विद प्रोविजंस हैव बीन मेड ऑन द लाइंस ऑफ द एनसीआईएम. नाउ दिस इज द लेटेस्ट, बट स्टिल द अप्रूवल इज पेंडिंग. अप्रूवल इज, once we get the approval, then it will go to the cabinet, and once it is approved by the cabinet, that it will be introduced in that. So this is the thing. But the trained manpower is required for drug sector, and this requirement of trained manpower, it is different from the requirement of the pharmaceutical. As Mr. Puranik told, and as Professor Chaudhary told, that our requirement of the manpower is different from the requirement of the pharmaceutical. Was add-on knowledge, add-on training, that is required. Apart from Ayurveda pharmacy, we also need to have training on the elements of modern pharmacy technology. So that's also required. Because if we want to indulge in R&D, we want to do innovation, so that means the global technology, emerging trends. So training on all those things have to be given to our Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani, and Naturopathic pharmacy. So the objective which we have kept in our mind in the pharmacy bill, which we are going to propose, that we set up a central pharmacy council, we'll have a central body, then there will be a small state pharmacy council, only of 3 officers, one administrator, one registrar, and one the chairman, and this will be responsible just to make a register of the pharmacists. Means whosoever want to go into the profession of pharmacy, he will have to get registered. So that work will be given to the state pharmacy council. Otherwise, we will not have a big paraphernalia like we have state board and state council or like that. Another is to appoint pharmacy development officer. So again, since as on date, the Ayush pharmacy education and the profession is not regulated. So from where these officers will come? So we will take those persons mainly from the teaching institution, the professors. They will help the state regulatory body, the state regulatory council, and the central the council, pharmacy council, to make the inspections and to recommend that, okay, what kind of post curricula, what kind of training requirements need to be put for these. That is why we have not given the name that the drug inspector or the pharmacy inspector. We have taken pharmacy sector, because we want to develop the pharmacy sector of Ayurveda. So that is why we are designating them pharmacy development officers, both at the central level as well as at the state pharmacy level. And then the responsibility to be given to this body to maintain the central register and to at the state level also. So these are the things. So with this, I conclude my presentation, and Thank you very much for this opportunity for me to share my views as a policymaker. And again, thankful to the organizers, Dr. Modha, and all the convener also, and the chairman and the vice chancellor of the university, and my colleagues, particularly Professor Chaudhary and Mr. Ranjit. I think they have given a lot of inputs, and I have picked up many points, and I think those will be on my screen over. Thank you very much.
For your in-depth, detailed speech on entire facets, covering entire facets of regulatory body. And we are having some queries, and I would like to give the information to all those participants who are asking the queries, that your queries will be answered soon. Once this session will be over, we will come to you and we'll solve your queries. And now, due to we are running out of time, I would like to call upon Dr. Vasudatta Kothari ma'am for the vote of thanks. Please, ma'am.
Namaskar. It is with pleasure that myself, Dr. Vasudatta Kothari, present the vote of thanks to the dignitaries of the university and today's webinar. We are highly obliged to our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Dr. Anup Thakur Sir, and Registrar, Shri H.P. Chala, for their consistent guidance and support. It is an honor to extend our courtesies to the guest speakers, each a stalwart in his field. We are obliged to Professor A.K. Chaudhary Sir for his informative speech. As rightly said, he is an institution by himself. We thank Shri Ranjit Puranik Sir for sharing the industrial views, enriching us with his in-depth knowledge of Ayurvedic pharmacy. We are extremely grateful to Dr. D.C. Katoch Sir for his valuable speech, enlightening us with his vast in-depth knowledge. We thank the staff and technical members, especially Mr. Biju John and Mr. Uday Donga. Last but not the least, I convey gratitude on behalf of my colleagues and myself to our young and dynamic principal, Dr. Jovan Modha Sir, who made this event possible and has keen interest in developing the institute at a global platform. Herewith, this session is over, but do not forget to join us from now onwards for pharma comments, cultural event, and alumni function. Thank you. Thank you, one and all.